ushers, will you please bring our family in? Friends, we will invite you to enjoy this time of preparation for worship as Patty continues to play music for us. The family needed to return home to retrieve an item that they wish to have for the worship center. So there'll just be a momentary delay. Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and greetings of grace and peace to all of you. Those of you who are gathered here today in the Wild Lake Interfaith Center, where St. John United Church worships every Sunday, and a special greeting to those who are meeting us today in the realm of live stream online. We thank you for gathering today to give thanks and to honor the life of Philip Minch Barnes. You have come because your family, or because your friends, perhaps old, longtime friends, or maybe newer friends, or because you've known Phil through some other connections in his life. Or maybe you are here because you wish to be a support to those who have known and loved him and are grieving, that you wish to be here to surround us with love and bear us up on our continuing journey. We have gathered to mourn the death of Phil and to give thanks for his life. And so for whatever reason you have come, we are glad. We are glad. We do ask you to silence your cell phones, and remember that if you need to leave during the worship service, there are restrooms and comfort facilities and water refill stations primarily behind the waterfall feature in the lobby and individual restrooms up to your left as you leave this. We do encourage you, if you wish, to stay masked while you are in the facility, and I can see that you have all distanced at your own comfort level as we have room to do that. My name is Mary Kay Canahan. I am the current pastor of this congregation. And with us today is Mr. Hewitt Tshome. Hewitt was an intern with our church in recent years, and he is a local hospital chaplain where he got to know Phil. And Hewitt is now prepared to receive a call for ordination in the Presbyterian Church USA. And I'm not sure if I do not see another of Phil's pastors, but we trust that the Reverend Lon Chestnut may be with us online as well. Friends, this will be a worship service in which Christian forms of worship take place, as that is the faith that Phil professed. I recognize that not all of you have chosen the Christian faith as your spiritual journey. And so during times in our worship service, especially during times of prayer, we invite you to remember Phil in whatever way resonates with your spirit and faith tradition. Our music today was chosen by Phil, and the opening hymn he wishes for you to stand and sing is "Here I Am, Lord." The words will be in front of you. Welcome to stand.
Thank you. Good morning. Please join me in our call to worship. We meet in the presence of God, who holds the keys of life and death.
We both believe and welcome God's presence.
We are here to celebrate and remember the life of Philip Minch Barnes, Jr. You may be seated. And now, please let us come before God in prayer. Receiving God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. We especially thank you, dear Lord, for your servant Phil, whose baptism is now complete and dead. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave him that kindled in him the love of your dear name, enabled him to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for him, death is past and pain ended, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared. Almighty God, in Jesus Christ, you promised many rooms within your house. Give us faith to see beyond touch and sight some sure sign of your kingdom. And when vision fails, to trust your love, which never fails. Lift heavy sorrow and give us good hope in Jesus, so we may bravely walk our earthly way and look forward to the glad reunion and the life to come. Lord, you consoled Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Phil and dry the tears of those who weep. You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow. You raised the dead of life. Give to our brother, dear Lord, eternal life. You promised paradise to the repentant thief. Bring Phil to the joys of heaven. Our brother was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give him fellowship with all your saints. He was nourished at your table on earth. Welcome him at your table in the heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrows at death of Phil, but let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. Amen. Please join me as we read our first scripture reading in unison. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul, leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yet though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Our second scripture reading comes from the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. For everything there's a season, and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time of love, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please join us in our second hymnal this morning, God of the Sparrow.
Actually, thank you, Patty. I'm going to continue with our gospel reading, but I'm glad to know that you all listened to the direction of your pastors. That's very encouraging. Our gospel reading today from the Holy Scriptures in the Bible come from the 14th chapter of the Gospel of John, and this is a selection of verses. These are the words attributed to Jesus speaking to his disciples. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may also be. And you know the way to the place where I am going. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. I've said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
Amen. Praise God for the gift and witness of God's greatness. Amen. Amen. Friends, will you pray with me? Loving God, may the words of my mouth and all that we say here today and the meditation of my heart and every heart here today be reflective of your grace, your goodness, and your love toward all that you have created. And may our worship today be pleasing and honoring and glorifying of you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, friends, I first met Phil and Andrea in July of 2013, when I was appointed to serve St. John United Church right here. Now, I say that I first met Phil and Andrea because I can hardly think of one without the other. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I also love the remark in Phil's bio that you have with you, that they had 52 years of marital bliss. All right. Now, that's a wonderful testament. And then that's your story, we're gonna stick with it. We will. And a good part of that joy and bliss was humor and some playfulness in relationship between Phil and Andrea. So you see in front of you a photograph that I received 3 weeks after I began my appointment here. So that was on July 24th, 2013. And that is Cheers with two cups of ice cream. And that is from the Lot of Flavors, I think that's called, ice cream shop on their way to Lake Michigan, to the cottage and home on the lake that they enjoyed so very much. And I remember saying to my children, hey, look what a fun congregation I'm going to serve. These are the kind of photos my congregants share with me. And I think I said something about, you know, living vicariously through them, and that what they represented there in their Cheers with a cherry amaretto or amaretto cherry ice cream was what I like to call the Methodist form of happy hour.
right. Amen. Amen. Well, this photo was soon to be followed a few days later by this one. It is a beautiful capturing of sunset from your home there in Michigan. And what I gathered from this is that Phil was often inspired by that setting and the sense of God and wonder in the transcendent. And over the years, he sent lots of pictures of the beach and the sunset and clouds, and particularly references to the wonder of a very rare green light at sunset that he captured in this photograph, Eric, to you and then to me. And here's what he said, the sunset with the green flash. I have heard of occasional green flashes under some conditions at sunset. Five of us watched the sunset tonight, and none of us saw the flash, but my phone caught it. And as he took this series of photographs, just in a very split second later, this one followed. Yes, that quickly it changed. And then he wrote this, "Enjoy the wonders of God, Phil." That was on Memorial Day weekend, 2017. Friends, our brother Phil was baptized and raised in the Christian tradition of the Roman Catholic Church. And there's an amazing gift in that tradition of the mystery and the means of grace of several sacraments, the mystery of our faith and the wonder of God. He was often inspired by the sights and signs of God's creation, especially at Lake Michigan. How many of you ever received views of sunsets, clouds, celebrations, beachside from him over the years? I imagine there would be family members in particular who got those. That's wonderful. I think he appreciated that part of creation and the gift of that place, Andrea, with your family, where he felt quietly close to God and the mystery of our faith. And so it does not surprise me that that impact would live on in his final wishes for his burial to be part of a living reef, buried in the ocean as part of a living reef and habitat off the coast of the sort of New Jersey, Delaware shore. He also found a great deal of inspiration and interest in faith through the summer sermon series and all the special guest preachers that would come to Epworth. And he would send back and bring back CDs of those preachers to inspire and share. And then in relationship with Andrea in his life, he had made his way to the Protestant tradition of Christianity. And this unique expression of Christian faith called St. John United in the United Methodist and Presbyterian USA churches. You get a sense of his appreciation for both the transcendent wonder and mystery of God and in the practical divinity of his service and the way he helped everyone in his life through the music that you're singing today. He helped pick this music. He chose it years ago. They are among his favorites. And we opened with, "Here I am, Lord," a servant saying yes to God's call to serve the suffering in the world. And after this, we will sing, "God of the sparrow, God of the whale." And we get that sense of God's transcendence. In all of this, where God might sometimes seem far off or mysterious, Phil felt most connected to his faith when he put his gifts in the service to others. And in some ways, I would say that Phil was a little restless in his faith. He was more than a little discontent at times with the institution of the church and seeking always to try to understand more, figure it out, better things, and inspire us. In the recent last years, however, he relinquished those agitations and became a lot more nonchalant. He was a struggling, questioning Christian. He was engaged in rigorous conversations in our Christian applications class that had robust intellectual discussions. And he was always willing to work or help out where needed. As I looked back through all of those emails over the past 9 years, see, this is the blessing of having a pastor that never totally clears out her inbox, where I found those photos, I also found a witness from Phil about a complete stranger, a woman in the neighborhood who reached out because she was in need of relocating from her apartment urgently. And without question, Phil signed up to help. And some of you were alongside him too. He has helped out with church members in uncertain housing scenarios. Multiple people have received transportation from Phil over the years to doctor's appointments, physical therapy, and various treatments, even when his own health was failing these past couple of years. We've got other pictures of him with Eric and Susie helping to decorate our sanctuary at Christmas time. And the flags of nations that you see around this room are ones that he would help install as we would celebrate and prepare for World Communion Sunday each year. He would show up to greet children on the first day of school at Bryant Woods Elementary School, our community partner. And as recent as December 2020, he was building desks for 50 children who did not have desks in their homes at which to study for our partnership. So Phil was unapologetically a struggling, questioning Christian who longed to make sense of his faith and reason. And we had good conversation about faith and God's work in our lives. He balanced this questioning and struggling with good doses of humor. And in the end, he decided that being part of organized religion and membership in the local church was not something that was essential for him. He decided not to worry about it all so much, and instead he invested himself in helping others in the world, making small differences here and there wherever he could. And I know that there's far more that went on than I could see. And even when his illness made life difficult in the past 2 years, he did as much as he could for as long as he could for others. In the words of the Holy Scriptures we've read today, we hear of a God who is like a loving shepherd, leading, guiding, feeding those in God's care for their whole lives. We read the reality of the rhythms of life, which balance and sometimes cancel out each other. And we hear of God's promises in Jesus' words to the disciples that he will prepare a way for them and send the Holy Spirit to be active in their lives, reminding them of all of God's teachings and the life-giving message that Jesus has brought even when they no longer see him, and assure them that he is waiting for them. I want to continue with a few verses of Ecclesiastes 3 after that rhythm of a time for every season. Here's what the scripture continues with verse 9 and says, "What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He's made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from beginning to end. And so I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor nothing taken away from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before God. That which is already has been, and that which is to be already is. And God seeks out what has gone by. I read that scripture because when I think of two cups of ice cream, being sort of capturing that moment of eating and drinking and being merry, and also the very practical toil of God's call in Phil's life to serve and help in quiet and unseen ways, that all of that was bound up in the sense of wonder that he has that he couldn't explain, but that he deeply appreciated and enjoyed in a simple sunset. So, friends, Phil was part of SJU for a long time, and he was always a little bit in the background and on the edge of things, not always in the middle or with the crowd. And I valued his opinion that spoke from the edges, even though I didn't always agree with his perspective, because I know enough to consider the truth of every voice that speaks, that there is a grain of prophetic wisdom in particularly ones who speak from those edges. And Phil stayed connected to the church. He came to worship. He was always helping with things. And I do see that as evidence of God working in him and showing him the way of Jesus' life-giving message to love one another. And it is as Christians that we're most reminded how to love one another by the life of God's child, Jesus, who came to us in human form to show us how to love each other, who was willing to endure tremendous suffering in this life, trusting completely in God, for something unseen yet real, like a sunset on a horizon, in which we see the beauty right on that line between, we might say, heaven and earth. But we also know by faith that there is something beyond what we see. That God assures us of that which we do not see but receive by faith, like a green flash that vanishes in a vapor into the eternity and held by God. It's like the promise of new life, which is a mystery and a hope that we hold on to by faith, that then by the death and the resurrection of Jesus 3 days later, that there is a time to be born, a time to die, and we might say, by faith, a time to live again. Knowing that God is prepared this way, knowing that God is with us and waits for us, even while we are imperfect people in this world, is grace. And when we realize that we don't do this life on our own and put our whole trust in that grace, then we're truly freed to love others in the way that God has shown us in Jesus the Christ. When I visited with Phil in the last months of his life, for which he was very appreciative and always said, thank you so much for coming. He was most concerned that the people in his life he loved were taken care of. And even in the last week of his life, when he was weak and not able to speak as much, he was so grateful for the presence of his family in Andrea and Eric and Susie, and for the church who was with him. Thank you for coming. Thank you for being here, he would say, even though I'm not part of the church anymore. And I said, but Phil, you are. We're family. being a member of the church doesn't change that. And he said, are we really family? I said, yes, we are. By faith, that is what God has revealed to us, that not one of us lives our lives separate and completely apart from the other. And particularly in the Christian tradition, in what we profess in our baptism, you know, we're baptized only using our first given name, not our family surname. Why is that? Because we are baptized into the whole family and household of God. We are the whole people of God. And so I assured him that even when we pull back or look in another direction, God has never turned away or let go of holding us by grace. As we prayed together, he was assured of God's love for him, which was being passed on through every one of you. And that's what Jesus was saying to his followers and to us today, where the Holy Spirit is always available to remind us daily of the teachings and promises of God in Jesus' life. And so I trust completely in God's grace that Phil's death meant a continuation of life and entrance into the fullness of God's loving presence. And we all can have that assurance by grace through faith in God's Son, Jesus Christ. And so if your heart is open and your mind prepared with these words, I invite you to take a moment to appreciate, to receive, to trust in the one whose resurrection has defeated sin and death and is, well, beyond the horizon of life that we see here in eternity. And so, friends, even though it's hard to say goodbye to the gift from God that is Phil, we're thankful and we're joyful for that which lives on in each of us and in the world for having known him and for what he has offered of himself. Thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, will you stand and join your voices together in this song of God's transcendence in creation, God of the sparrow, God of the whale.
Thank you.
Please join me in reciting the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who is in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, you may be seated. This is a time in our worship where we welcome those who have known and loved Phil to witness to his life. And so we begin by inviting his son, Eric Barnes.
You have to bear with me. My mother gave me a lot of letters to hand out, and I don't know where my speech is. First, I'd just like to say thank you to everyone who came. I know some of you traveled long distances, and I know my dad would be very happy to see all of you together. For those of you that know, I'm Eric, my father's only child, and standing here today, I realize how fortunate I was to have him as my father. There are no words to express his influence in my life. It's through his example that I learned to be the man that I am today, and I strive always to reach his example. My father was a hardworking, strong, loving, and gentle man. He loved his family and was deeply devoted to his mother and I. He showed strength right up until the last day, and I don't know how long this will take for my mother and I to grieve this tremendous loss. My father was also my best friend and the most important person in my life. His memory will carry on, and once again, thank you for coming.
Amen. Amen. May we welcome Mr. Charles Whitaker, please. Oh, you would like, okay. We will welcome Phil's sister, Carol Small. Would you be more comfortable doing it from this level?
Yeah, can I just move on? Or just stay here?
Will we hear you from the singing mic?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure.
That'll be fine. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. And thank you for coming this morning, too, and braving this weather. I am Carol Small, Phil's older sister. The man that you all know as Phil was, to me, Barney Barnes. His birth certificate reads Philip Minch Barnes Jr., as our father, of course, was Philip Minch Barnes Sr. But from an early on, my parents decided, instead of calling him Jr., to call him Barney. Barney Barnes was born on June 29th, 1946, at 11:36 p.m. I was born on June 29th, 1944, 11:36 a.m. As the years went on, my father used to say, now that was really Planned Parenthood. In later years, if we were particularly out in a restaurant together, my brother would come up with the idea or tell the waitress that the story about us being born and around the same time, and he would always ask, who do you think is the older one? And he was very pleased if someone pointed to me. I wasn't. It was interesting to hear that he was driving people around for appointments in this area. I knew he did a little bit of it, but I didn't know as that he did as much as he did. But that makes me recall a childhood memory. Our mother, who was a great volunteer in our church, would frequently drive the nuns to an appointment in the afternoon, and my brother and I at that time were too young to stay home alone. So we would have to go along for the ride. And we quickly learned to crouch down in the back seat as low as possible so that there wasn't a chance of any of our friends seeing us if they were outside when we rode by. When Barney went off to college, everyone started calling him Phil, even our parents. But to me, my husband, he was always Barney, and to my daughters and granddaughter, he was always Uncle Barney. Well, at Allegheny College, my brother was fortunate enough to meet Andrea Whitaker. They were introduced by Kirk Borland, who you will be hearing from next. They were married soon after graduation, and as mentioned before, were married a little over 52 years. Barney and Andy, and my husband and Jim and I enjoyed each other's company and spent many happy years together. After my husband died 11 years ago, my brother stepped right up and became my go-to man. In addition to being available for support and advice, he became my Mr. Fix-It. Whenever he and Andy would visit, he would bring along his toolbox and I would give him right the first thing, my honey-do list, which he always completed before he went home. Barney and Andy were fortunate enough to retire in 2006 and were able to enjoy many retirement years together. Particularly during that time, my brother enjoyed keeping in touch with friends and family, whether in person, by phone, or by email. There was nothing he liked better than to be asked a question by someone, and in order to provide the best answer he could, he would settle in his recliner with his computer on his lap and happily search for hours in order to find the right answer. Those of us that witnessed this couldn't believe it that he could spend so much time. After he became ill with his disease, his world began to shrink. He was confined to home a great deal, and that was because he had trouble breathing and became exhausted so easily. Unfortunately, the last couple of months of his life were mainly spent in the hospital while the disease progressed through his body. During that time, Andy demonstrated great love for her husband by being with him from early morning to late at night and trying to do whatever she could do to make him more comfortable. Eric visited too very frequently from Michigan and was there for his father and his mother, helping out in any way he could. Phil Barnes was a good man who loved his family, valued his friendships, and quietly tried to make the world a better place for all. I'd like to conclude with a poem entitled, "His Journey's Just Begun." Don't think of him as gone away, his journey's just begun. Life holds so many facets, this earth is only one. Just think of him as resting from the sorrows and the tears in a place of warmth and comfort where there are no days and years. Think how he must be wishing that he could know today, that we could know today, how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in the hearts of those he touched, for nothing loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much.
We have two other scheduled witnesses, and this is Charles Whitaker. You think?
I've been called worse.
You think? Okay.
Especially by my wife. Good morning. The green flash really does exist. People don't believe it. You see it about watching sunsets about once or twice a summer. It's just It does exist, and he's lucky to have caught it. I'm Andy's older brother, one of three. In 1969, the three of us were ecstatic welcoming Phil to the family. Andy could then spend her time and effort on correcting him rather than the three of us. She did a good job of that. I quickly found out that Uncle Phil, in any project, planned and then planned it and then reevaluated it and then planned it some more, got started at the project and then planned it some more. I believe that was very helpful and beneficial for his job as an analyst for Amtrak. When given a project or a projection for the future or analysis of past performance, he would look at many different projections, different variables, apply them in different ways, and come up with the best profit, possible profit for Amtrak, which was usually a loss. I have personally watched him spend hours on a financial report, and he would have questions of why it was reported in this manner, or perhaps how something could have been reported differently. This is not just personal finances, but with different organizations. As a homeowner, he became interested in construction and the use of tools, which had been lacking in his growing years. He put this same obsession in construction, in planning and building. In 1980, after they had moved into their current house for about four years, my wife Shirley and I and my parents came down to visit for Thanksgiving. On Thanksgiving Day, Phil asked my dad and I if he would help him put him in a doorbell. Yes, no problem. We measured. My dad was ready to drill. Hold on, I need to check something. Okay, we measured it again, and my dad was ready to drill. Hold on, I need to check it again. And the third time, with hold on, I need to check it again, my dad said, don't worry, the hole's drilled. That doorbell wire is still in place. I could go on with stories and stories, but one other one. Again, Thanksgiving Day, 1980, 30 years after they moved into their current house. Shirley and I came down to visit with Amy, my daughter, and her fiance. On Thanksgiving Day after dinner, Phil casually asked if Kevin and I could show him how to replace one of the builder's doors, which they had been talking about for doing it for many, many years. Of course, Kevin and I know things about construction. Friday morning early, before Black Friday sales, Phil and I rushed to Lowe's, bought five doors, rented a truck, and brought them home. By that time, Kevin had removed most of the doors, frames. Kevin and Phil replaced all the doors. Andy was dumbfounded. Five doors in two-thirds of a day and done, not years. Phil had planned on doing one and over the next several years, replacing the others. Over the years, I have learned and done many projects with Phil in Maryland, in Michigan, and enjoyed working it, but sometimes very frustrated with the slow-moving planning part of the project. The projects always turned out well. His finishing touches were always the best. Uncle Phil, as all the kids knew him, I will miss you. Your planning on projects, your work ethic, your laugh, your sincere interest in children's, and we most of all, we will miss your Googling almost every conversation or planning discussion. Uncle Phil, we all miss you. Thank you.
And the fourth member of the family, Mr. Kirk Borland.
Well, I get to say good morning to you as well. I probably, next to Carol, knew Phil the longest of anyone here. My wife Lucy believes that people come into our lives for, as she puts it, a reason, a season, or for life. And when Philip Barnes came into my life, it was certainly to be for a long, long life. Born a year apart, we both grew up in a suburb south of Pittsburgh, but we didn't meet until Phil's freshman year at Allegheny College in Meadville, Pennsylvania. It was 1964. I was the treasurer of the local Theta Chi fraternity, and Phil was doing the rounds of Fraternity Rush, trying to decide if a social fraternity was of any interest. Well, being treasurer, you might imagine that I took immediate interest in this lanky kid from my hometown. After all, we had beds in the fraternity house to fill. But there was something else. From the moment I met Phil, he struck me as the genuine article, the real deal. He was a fundamentally easygoing, happy guy, devoid of pretense, a man of his word, someone you could trust to do the right thing. Those of us in the fraternity were happy to call him brother, and I was fortunate to have Phil as my roommate for the next 3 years. Now, if Phil were listening at this moment, he would feel obliged to remind me of the time that I allegedly threatened to ignite the upper bunk where he was sleeping. I don't really have any clear memory of that, and importantly, no witnesses that I'm aware of. In truth, though, Phil and I were well matched, reasonably responsible students. We had our moments, and Phil was ever the supportive brother, the good sport, the reliable ally. One fall night in Phil's sophomore year, I got the idea that my old high school girlfriend, whom I hadn't seen in 2 years, would be thrilled by a surprise visit. One minor obstacle, she was a student at Penn State, some 150 miles away. Fortunately, Phil had his family's convertible in the fraternity's parking lot. And some 3 hours later, we were roaming the Penn State campus trying to find my old flame before student curfew. Long story short, we found her. Believe it or not, she was less than thrilled. And we were back at our fraternity house before the sun came up. But what a great bonding road trip filled with hours of philosophy that only college men might appreciate, and doing our version of Saturday Night Live's Wild and Crazy Guys. Phil was the sibling that I never had. And I liked Phil so much that I was inspired to introduce him to his future wife, my cousin Andrea Whitaker, also an Allegheny College undergrad at the time. And I would have happily been the best man at their wedding in 1969 had the U.S. Army not intervened with an all-expense-paid trip for me to Southeast Asia. After college, Phil and I went our separate ways, building our careers and families, but we were never far from each other. We would talk occasionally to trade advice about monumental issues like changing jobs or making investments, and we would reconnect at periodic family gatherings marking holidays, weddings, graduations, spring outings, and especially the summers at the Whitaker family cottage on Lake Michigan. Whenever we got together, it would be it was easy to pick up the thread of our lives and our stories as if no time had intervened. And on such occasions, I would often see Phil with a hammer or an electrical diagram or a meat carving knife in hand. For you see, he was always busy, always eager to help, always ready to lend a hand with whatever needed attention. That's just who he was. And even when his health began to fail, Phil remained that eternally upbeat, happy guy I first met at the frat house, because he found joy in doing things, making plans, helping others, contributing to the cause. What a life lesson for us all. This past summer, Lucy and I vacationed briefly with a couple who introduced us to a Jewish tradition meant to honor those who have passed away with these simple words: may their memory be a blessing. I know the memory and legacy of Phil Barnes will forever be a blessing in my life, and I hope for each of you. Thank you.
We give thanks for those words and witness to the gift and life of Phil Barnes. There may be some among you here who would wish to just lift up a moment, a memory, an appreciation for the family. I would first like to ask if anyone from the church of which Phil was a part might have a word to say. And perhaps there would be someone from a former workplace or a neighbor. And we'll do this not for a long time, depending on how long you all talk. And we'll draw this to a close, and hopefully you'll continue your conversations over lunch. Is there anyone who would like to lift up a reflection? I see Mr. John Worley worked extensively with Phil. I'm going to bring the microphone to you.
Yes, thank you.
Yes.
Well, I met Phil on the finance committee. We became ex-finance clerks, and that's where our friendship deepened. We would talk on the phone, and Ann would here in the other room and say, "Oh, that's Phil again." And we would go on for solve the problems of our family and the world and solve them again. He was quirky and thoughtful, maybe too thoughtful, but he was a friend that I will remember and truly miss.
Thank you, John. Mr. Alvin Thompson, and then I'll come over to Mr. Nat Barnes and Roy Ferguson.
Phil was a great guy. After Phil retired, it just happened that one day I was driving home from someplace and discovered that something was wrong with one of my eyes. And by the next morning, I realized I was losing sight in it. And I just drove myself from Columbia to Baltimore to an ophthalmologist, found out that I was had a detached retina, and then I drove to Reisterstown for outpatient surgery. Well, when Phil found out that all that happened, because I didn't have time to tell anybody about it, he said, "Well, you know, you should have called somebody." Well, it just happened that only lasted for a few days, and I let him know. And the great thing about it wasn't just that he gave rides, but it was the conversation from Columbia to Reisterstown and then from there back. And I always liked Phil, but he was really a great guy with all kinds of ideas, and I'll just remember that, yeah. Always.
Thank you. Nat, did I see your hand? Yes. Mr. Nathaniel Barnes.
I'm Nathaniel Barnes. I've been already warned by the Master Sergeant here that I shouldn't talk long, so I'll try to be as brief as I can. I just wanted to express that sentiment I felt from this family. It's a lot of love, a lot of support, and was particularly touched by the tribute of his friend. And I wish that when I go, there will be someone who could say similar things about me.
Amen.
But God bless all of you, the family. We pray for you, and everything will be okay. My wife and I have a small foundation called the Aurora Foundation that Phil has been very, very supportive of. And we've seen that he's asked that any contributions made be made to the Aurora Foundation, which we have decided we will establish a Phil Barnes Memorial Scholarship Fund, where we will award annually to a young man and a young woman in Liberia has need for an education, and funds will be covered, their tuition and whatever their needs might be, in honor of Phil's memory. Thank you, and may Phil live, rest as well as he lived. God bless all of you.
Oh, amen, amen. Yes, friends. So the Aurora Foundation, you'll find that information in your worship bulletin, and that is supporting an orphanage that Dawn and Nat run, where the children and youth who grow up under their oversight and care and nurturing have been able to celebrate that every high school senior has gone on to higher education in that country. And so that has been a tremendous lifelong blessing. Thank you. Thank you. Roy?
Pastor Mary Kay has told you about Phil supporting a woman who needed to relocate. I just want to add a little on to that. First of all, it was Phil who made all the arrangements for the truck we used. And then as we worked, Phil brought in a slogan for the effort. He said, let's form a new company. Let's call it Six Geezers in a Truck. Always bringing that combination of service and good humor.
Oh, praise God. Thank you. Yeah. There's someone else? Oh, hi, Linda. Lara?
Hi, my name is Linda, and Phil and his son generously served with the Appalachia Service Project. At that program, we are conscious of being stewards of our resources, so we teach our volunteers measure twice, cut once. Today, thank you, I learned that he truly embodied year-round that philosophy. So thank you for sharing.
Mr. Dave Dowds.
Thank you. Phil was a wonderful friend for many, many years. Well, Judy and I were here in Columbia and after we moved to Charlestown. And I'm now your visiting spectral presence from Charlestown, in fact. Haven't been here in quite a while. And I particularly remember when I had a pretty severe health crisis 5 years ago in the hospital and in rehabilitation at Charlestown. Phil was always there as part of a group of people that talked to me and sort of helped me reassemble myself mentally after all this happened. He was very selfless, very just a wonderful friend, and I and Judy and I both will miss him greatly. And he was a blessing to us. Thank you.
Amen. Let's see, one more over here. Oh, let me catch this lovely lady.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Phil was my buddy. He was my buddy. I miss him so much. I look forward to him every Sunday at church, messing with me, picking on me, hitting me, and making me smile. But thank God I have Andrea. Andrea, we love you. We love Philip, we love you. We thank God for his life. God bless us all.
Thank you. All right, one more. And as we hear these last remarks, you may have some other thoughts in your hearts and minds that you wish to express, and I will encourage you to think about putting them in writing and sending them in an email or in the post to the family, your thoughts and capturing of who Phil has been and what he has meant in your life will mean a great deal to the family moving forward.
Hi, my name's Robinson. Phil is my uncle. Sorry, I usually don't have problems at funerals. But, you guys heard about Michigan, Ludington. It's a wonderful place. And for me growing up, it was hard to be able to go. Because my mother and father were working a lot, and my Aunt Andy and my Uncle Phil, every summer, would take about a month of their summer to care for me so that I could experience Michigan. They didn't. Excuse me. They didn't ever ask for anything for it. And I remember, you know, growing up there, you gain a lot from the people you grow up around. And Uncle Phil, as we all know, did a lot of research. He knew everything he ever talked about, and he knew it. And we have a family trust that helps support and protect the cottage. And we were gonna have a big meeting one day. Every year we would get together to discuss grievances or how we felt that the trust should be handled. And we were sitting there the night before, and I was sitting with Uncle Phil on the porch, and I said, Uncle Phil, you know, I have an opinion. I was 12. but I was a beneficiary of the trust. And Uncle Phil said to me, well, what's your opinion? And we talked for about an hour or two. And he said, well, have you prepared your remarks? And I said, no, I'm 12. I'm going into a room with I don't know how many doctors and lawyers, and I'm not going to stand up and act like I know something. And he said, well, I've reviewed the trust documents at length, as we all know he did with everything he ever looked at. I see nothing in there that says a 12-year-old can't raise his hand and say something. Ooh. And that was him. And I felt a little bit of him saying, Robinson, pick up the microphone. Say something. Oh, Phil was quite a man. Annie and Andy, if you ever need anything, thank you.
You may. Beautiful and fitting tributes to a life and gift, and I know still not yet the fullness of who Philip Minch Barnes has been in our lives. And so again, I do encourage you, if you have memories, reflections, humor, encouragement that you wish to share with the family, please do it. It will be a comfort to them in the days and months, years to come, part of the legacy and life of Phil. Friends, we will invite you at this time to stand and join your voices once more for the hymn that Phil has chosen for you, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Friends, Phil's family wishes to invite you to continue your time together over a reception just outside of these doors. And because they wish to capture everyone who has been here to celebrate and remember the gift of Phil, they remind you to sign the guest book, which is on the podium out there. And then if you will please allow the family to depart first. Right? Friends, receive this blessing. Gracious God, we give thanks for the gift of today, for all that it has held. We give thanks especially for the gift of your beloved child, Phil, who is yours, was ours for a time, and is yours eternally. May you comfort those who mourn in this time and place, and draw us closer to one another, that we might walk by faith, be resilient in our hope, and love one another as we go in peace to love and serve God. Amen.